वेलकम टू द शो जॉन सर।
थैंक यू वेरी मच अजय, इट्स अ प्लेजर मीटिंग यू हियर.
सर इट्स
आई नेवर
ग्रेट।
थॉट दैट यू हैड दिस ग्रेट चैनल गोइंग एंड वर्किंग एंड इट्स सो पॉपुलर.
सर इट्स माय प्लेजर दैट
कांग्रेचुलेशंस
यू
फॉर
कुड
दैट.
कम हियर सर। लवली
या
सर।
इट्स
बिफोर
माय प्लेजर
यू नो
टू,
आई
माय
वाज
प्लेजर.
रिसर्चिंग व्हाट क्वेश्चंस टू आस्क यू। सो आई
या
वांटेड टू सो आई जस्ट वेंट ऑन विकिपीडिया एंड saw when Guna was released. So it was 1991. So it's been almost 30 years since Guna is released. And I remember the first time I saw Guna. I was in school and I saw it on a TV channel. And you know, some movies, after you watch the movie, you remember the time when you saw the movie and where you saw it. Like if the during earthquake times and tsunami times, you know, we have that visceral memory of, you know, how we felt in that time. So like Guna is one of that movie where I remember, you know, which room I was sitting and what model TV I was watching. So I was thinking that this must be a great feeling to know that even after, you know, 30 years. A movie, when I think of the movie, it can bring back the same feeling. And not only for me, because I am invested in movies and stuff, even for my non-filmy friends, you know, they have the same feeling. Have you ever thought that, you know, how does this script hold on and give this feeling to people after, even after 30 years?
See, Ajay, one thing is a writer may not be able to judge it well as he writes. You know, all you can judge is how sincere or how emotional he himself is when he writes. So when I say a writer has to go through that trip of I would call it maybe you would have heard this word earlier, it's called writing from the heart. This process is a very, I would call it, maybe it's very easy to hear or maybe slightly very ornamental to hear, but at the same time, when you write from your heart, you're actually investing the entire experience of your life because it comes from your subconscious. That's what we call it, writing from the heart. So in this process, the writer may not have reasons. The writer may just go for an exercise or go with an exercise as an outflow of emotions flow from him. It's an outflow of emotions from the writer. And then you write. And it's not guided by reason at that point. So when you have written something, or maybe it's a very crude form, you need to revise it, rewrite it, embellish it in a long process after that. But probably Guna is one of those movies, a couple of movies more, I would say, Chanakya, my first film, and all these. But at the same time, Guna has the layers of character, and it also came from my heart because I had a commitment to define something to myself. That was the process. So this is exactly when I ask young writers, if they come to me and say, well, what do you want to write? Maybe they want to write this, they want to write that. But I give them a question. Usually I give them a question. Will it change you when you write this? This is the $1 million question. This is the perennial question. Is it going to change me when I write Guna? So my perspective about love, I was actually searching for love unconditional because I myself was going through a problem. Oh, it is a life problem. Everyone would encompass that at some point of time. So Guna is an outcome of my personal perils or personal deficits. And then I am trying to define myself through that. What is unconditional love? And this unconditionality is attributed to a schizophrenic mind. So when you say, when you have a sane mind, the definitions always come back to conditionality of love. Only a unconditional love can persist or can be embraced by a schizophrenic mind. So basically this evolved. And I never thought that the character Kamal Haasan sir did was perennial, and he embellished it so well. He just incarnated this whole concept of guna into him, and he made it a perennial thing. So when it comes to this 30 years, so many people asked me, or there was discussions about why guna exists even now in this modernized world or a different world. I just give them one answer, is because the emotion that you instill in a character always survives time. And human emotion still persists. That's the proof of guna, basically. So this is what I have to say. I never thought guna will survive. But 25 years of guna, when they celebrated, I was the happiest man in my solemn corner of my room. I was the happiest man because I could see the character surpassing the creator. Mm-hmm. Understand, this basically is the greatest applaud and gift that guna gives me. When you ask about guna to me, 30 years, they don't ask about Saab John, they ask about guna. Mm-hmm. Understand? Yeah. So this is basically the humble actualization a writer can expect when he writes from the heart. But he never could think it could survive 30 years. And it survives 30 years. Most of those, let us say Mughal-e Azam, a movie which was made in 1960s, or Kagaz Ke Phool, which was even made earlier, by written by Abrar Alvi. It's a very seldom, that name may be a very strange name for you. But when you see that movie, you just stand up and wanted to embrace the writer and the creators. What a wonderful movie it is. It's in black and white. It has all the conditions of an old movie. But the emotions stand. The characters stand. The deficit of love is experienced within even the conditions that we are going through now. This is the perennial outcome of writing from the heart. I hope I have told enough of what that, otherwise you have more questions to come from. But this is what a writer has to go through. When he does that, well, he has made his day, or he has made his days. That's it. And don't look up to a result. It will come to you at some point.
Mm-hmm. So when you were talking about, you had a question in your mind and you were searching for an answer to yourself. So it must have been a very, a deep question, or a very, I don't know whether it was a dark time or a very obviously an emotional time, and something came out of that. I have, from whatever small stuff I have written also, sometimes the very emotional work comes after I've gone through a dark phase, maybe a breakup or something. But I wonder that, do I have to, face such dark moments in my life to, bring out a script? Can't I just...
You have a point there, but at the same time, mostly a writer is best influenced by agonies than happiness. That's what I realized. When you have sorrow or agony or anguish, there is some kind of a chemical, or I would call it a psychophysical change that happens to a writer, that he is induced, or he has a fresh impetus to write, because he has psychological wounds, and it pains you, and then you write. It doesn't mean that most of the writers are influenced in their agony or anguish than joy and happiness or pleasant conditions. Pleasant conditions are always enjoyed. You enjoy those pleasant conditions. So that's exactly what I say. When a writer is given the best of life and the comforts of life, he better would have a drink and sleep, because he wants to enjoy it. not write stories much. But when it comes to agonies, it actually wakes you up. And there is always a digging. There is always a kind of a research or trying to realize what this is, why this happens to you. The same question I ask, why do this happen to me? This is a question that we always ask. Why do these things happen to me? This is what I mean by the impetus to write. I would say, Ajay, this is not just an impetus to write. This is a universal arrangement and outcome of stories. That's why we love stories. We are trying to define this life far and better through stories. That's what actually stories give you. Right from, I would call it probably the cognitive revolution that happened to Homo sapiens. It started that way. And we are trying to decipher something that you don't know. And we are trying to analyze if I am truly happy with this life. And if I am not, usually we are not. And if I am not, I am trying to redefine it. And this redefinition actually is connected through stories and elements of stories. And probably figuring out through stories, if this happens to them in the characters that we see. We are trying to correlate with our own life and make assessments, make revisions. And when that makes you happy, you go home happy. This is not today's circumstances. This has happened even in Aristotelian era or in long back. In Greek theater, they used to say there is always this, that pity and terror is what they used to call it. People wanted emotional cleansing usually. And for those emotional cleansing, they come to the theater and watch plays where characters go through hardships and pains and agony. And they cry with the character and go home. That's why there were only tragedies in early Greek theater. Comedy came a lot later.
What happened to the tragic genre, sir? Why do you think that changed over?
Tragedy eventually changed because at some point of time, most of life conditions are defined as tragic conditions because our wants, our desires are always obstructed. If we have the life which we want to live, there is no thrill of life. So we always have that's why even in economics, we say that our wants are insatiable. That's a core element of economics. So as human wants can never or rather very difficult to get satisfied, there are always obstacles coming. And that makes you unhappy. That gives you pain. And most of these insatiable wants stay unsatisfied. So this is, most of our life conditions are like this. We dream a lot. We have a lot of dreams. But do we get all those dreams come true? No. But still we dream. So there is always this tendency to define fresh dreams of life and redefine our lives. Stories actually give you that. That's why right from our infancy, as Amma gives you the lullaby, you're fascinated by that. You're actually the imagination. Imagination is something which is coming to Homo sapiens or humankind as I would call it long back as an emotional code inside us through cognitive revolution. So there is a lot to speak and go deeper into that. This is why we are still connected with stories. Hope I answer clarity.
Yeah, we are back, sir. We are back.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So when you were Talking that about the emotional cleansing, and see, in order for a writer to, you know, elicit that emotional cleansing in the audience, he has to feel like them, I suppose, the audience. He has to have a feeling of how would the audience go through the emotional arc and stuff. So naturally, he would need a lot of empathy as a human being to, you know.
Yeah.
So is it possible to develop that empathy? Because I sometimes feel like sometimes some people might not have that much empathy as others. I don't know. I'd be judging.
See, one thing I'll tell you, when we talk about empathy, this is again, it is a psychological state that we pass through at some point of our interactiveness with other human beings. So let us say, what do you mean by empathy? When you say, I am empathetic, I empathized with that character when I saw that movie. When we say that, what do we go through that? We actually put ourselves in that character's space. This is what empathy means. We try to put ourselves in that character's space and look at the sadness or conditions that he experienced or the problems that he experienced. So we have to look at that condition and at par with what I would have gone through had these things happened, what I would have done had these things happened. So this is basically the understanding of an emotion of another person under certain circumstances. It's called empathy. So I would call there are some divisions to it. There are in empathy, you can just say there is a cognitive empathy. Cognitive means, suppose if Ajay is experiencing pain and or experiencing a certain circumstance of life, and you are going through an emotional turmoil or passing through that emotion, I should be able to recognize that in you. That is the cognitive empathy. Then once I define that, okay, he is going through that because of this, that I recognize, sometimes there is a second part to it, that I become emotional, I go through emotional empathy. So I attach myself to more or less the same kind of emotion that the character passes through. And I cry along with you or laugh along with you. I get angered along with you. All this happens. This is again the emotional kind of segmentation to empathy. And the third, and probably the more vital when it comes to watching movies, is the compassionate empathy. The compassion actually happens when I know that the character is going through this perilous thing. I can understand the emotion. And I want to do something to save or come something at par with or something to help the character achieve certain things in these dire circumstances. So there are three types or three segments to empathy. While you watch a movie or while you try to foresee things or look at people going through a bad patch or some problems, I think this is a process of educating yourself. Empathy is a process of educating yourself. When you say, can it be acquired? Probably most of us go through that when you go through very dangerous or precarious conditions and when we come out of it. We say that, oh, he has gone through a great wisdom of life. We just misunderstand empathy.
So do you mean when we go through a situation in real life?
Yes, in real life.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
When we go through a situation in real life,
mm-hmm.
we try to, when we see others in the same situation,
mm-hmm.
I can well understand that situation.
Yeah, makes sense.
So my outlook to realizing or responding to that situation changes because I myself have gone through that. That's one way to look at it. When you watch characters go through certain life conditions in movies, I well can understand, oh, I also would have gone through this had this been the situation. That's another way to look at it. I haven't gone through it, but probably I could also go through the same side or same pit of things. Then probably this is the way I'm going to react, and I get a learning process through it. That's generally what, when we watch movies and acquire this empathy, is it is a learning process. It's actually acquiring some sort of an empirical experience, or rather, it's not empirical data that we get. Through somebody's experience, we are acquiring knowledge or we are acquiring wisdom. That again is something that we get through stories. Because Ajay, one thing that we really have to understand here is story is not a separate thing from life. We can relate with stories as only extensions of life. That's why we keep on watching movies or watching stories. Movies are an audiovisual stories. So we really need to go for tangible conditions of life and learn from it. So empathy actually connects that way. Empathy actually connects that way. And probably we get a lot wiser through stories. The impact of stories is not just entertainment. That is, I think, a misunderstanding. We are actually learning life through stories, giving more of definitions through stories. Look at stories that, even if it makes you laugh or makes you cry or make you angry, all these are definitions of life. That's why you get angry. You laugh, you cry. You're going through that extended life that you watch in movies. That's why movies are vital for our lives. Stories are vital for our lives. You cannot just evade it, or you cannot just throw it away. I'm talking about movies in the present tense, or even the past tense, or even the future tense, whichever kind of movies or stories that we encompass. That's going to affect, that's going to help you and affect you.
So when you talk about movies in the present age, I would like, from the advent of, I would say, the social media, I think it's been 10 years. So the past 10 years, how do you see, you know, people's attitude or their relationship with stories have changed, you know?
Ajay, I don't think the perspective is not changed. I don't think so. But what I feel is the outlook to life is slowly, gradually changing with many reasons. The outlook to life. So that outlook to life may have its impact in the stories too. Because stories are nothing but extensions of life.
Mm-hmm.
The outlook to, let us say, the outlook to love. 10 years before or 15 years before, and the outlook to now are, I think, are varied. It has probably maybe the privacy and individuality of love. I want my space in love. I am not likely to compromise that because this is not my space. All these have come to you.
Mm-hmm.
Probably we were, the morality is slightly shifting, or the moral norms are slightly shifting. So basically earlier we used to have 100% morally positive protagonists, which in stories and movies we used to support. But here those 100% protagonists are shifting, positive protagonists are shifting to neutral protagonist. who have 50% goodness and 50% moral negativity. We accept it. Because we think that today's life is like that.
Is it also...
We accept him.
Sorry, is it also because we have realized that, you know, I am not as 100% morally good as I thought I was? Are we...
No, it is not... See, morality is... Ajay, here the basic question is about defining the morality. What is morality? So when you talk about morality vitiated, morality harm, morality hurt, because apart from the social, societal morality, these are all societal morality. And you have a conscience within you. This is always in struggle. So I have my reasons for doing it, and the society is not giving leverage to that or doesn't understand it. So I have my morality is been personally defined by me, which the society opposes. This is our struggle. So the conscience is again something which we develop, like the subconscious. The conscience is an archive of moral layers that has been inculcated to you, thrust on you. All this happens with that conscience. This is, I cannot call it eroding. I am just saying that it's all shifting because of the life patterns that we have. The life patterns are changing. We are getting more and more like to be superhuman than human. We are trying to be superhuman than humans, which is, I think, the socio-psychological change which is happening. This has been predicted too earlier, but we are at that tip of things where slightly we are getting into this more than the emotional quotients or emotionality is slightly drifting more towards the artificially generated intelligence. And we are trying to find ways and means to accommodate it. For that, your morality actually shifts for your emotional conveniences. These are things that work in today's world. That's one. Two, I would very openly say that we are actually, the modernity actually is giving a bit of confusion to what exactly is wisdom. The definition of wisdom is shifting because we don't have enough opportunity or possibility to go through life. That's what I said about the empirical data that we are talking about. Like the learning by experience is diminishing. Rather, we are given statistical information and we take it at the click of a button, we get the information readied on a computer screen or a mobile phone screen, and we take it as wisdom. So we don't live a life to earn that wisdom. It is again that quote that happened, where is the life lost in living? This is actually the case which is happening to us now. We are not living that life.
But it's
we are being entangled.
It sounds quite sad, sir. I don't know. It feels like...
Yeah, it is a dystopian thought. It's a dystopian thought. It's not a utopian concept. It's a dystopian thought because of all the possibility of life being made easy by industrial outputs. This is what is making the havoc in our lives. I'm against industry patterns but our life has been moduled or life has been directed by industry. Our life is directed by mobile phone industries now, mobile screens now. That's why cameras become cheaper for you and the whole audiovisual system or audiovisual making has become democratized. How did it happen? Because the industry wanted it. It's not It's not that something emerged like that. It was purposefully conducted. And we are sort of, we are being used to it. These are all thrust on us. There is no other go but to go by. So it's an industrial necessity, not a life necessity.
So where do you see a writer's role here, sir? It seems like, you know.
No, I think I would call it the writer's role. I don't know, in an interview of late, somebody asked this question. It was in Malayalam Daily last Sunday. They asked the question, what did life teach you with all the troubles in this cinema career that you had gone through and ups and downs that you've gone through? What did it teach you? Is what he asked. I said, it taught me only one thing, to live with humility. You need to live with humility. The humble ways of life is the most needed at this hour. So I should be able to, I shouldn't be drawn by the consumerism which is thrust on me. I shouldn't be affected by the demonstrations that is thrust on me.
But how do you do
because
that?
Because even if I...
How do you stay affected?
I think I should be able to walk around. I should board the buses. I should lead the way a common man without all this technology leads a life and look at it.
Mm-hmm.
And with ambitions within the limits of certain possibilities. So the rat race is something which is thrust on you. What does it give you? So this is what the writers have always been trying to enumerate things that way. We need to look at life in an agrarian way than an industrialized way or industrial.
Mm-hmm.
What is this agrarian life? Agrarian way of living is you can live easily well if you have if everything that nature gives you. But when I say I need to have a car, I buy it just to show others that I have a car. It is not that I need that car. I wear this branded shirt because I'm having this interview, so many people would see me wearing this branded shirt. So I wear this shirt. I don't need to wear this shirt. I can even wear a normal white shirt and come here. But why do I do it? Because I am thrust with an industrial ambition by someone that if you wear this shirt, my capacities are exaggerated. I will be looked upon better than good. So I value it because it's unnecessary and it is unnecessary for me. This is what I mean by you are falsely directed by information. Then, and this is not to tell you the truth, this is not a branded shirt. I've been using it for the last 7 years. So this is the only shirt I have right now. So that's why I'm wearing. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is it's a very, very, I would call it very dangerous way of life that we are going through.
So if, let me give a scenario, sir. I'm an young writer, you know, wants to write stories for movies or for OTT platforms and stuff. So he knows that he has to make money by selling his stories. And the people who would give him money are the producers, you know, who want to produce stuff to fit inside the market economy system. They have their idea of the target audience and stuff. So me coming with all this baggage of, you know, I want to be empathetic and original and have this true purpose to myself, where do I navigate in this situation?
Well, I would call it's very difficult to choose. It's very difficult to choose. But at the same time, you can make a prototype, is what I say. See, I'll tell you something. There is of late in these lockdown days, in Malayalam, there is a couple of guys, 2-3 youngsters, you know, they started making a series called The Premier Padmini. This is what I watched a couple of videos they made. This was actually, like anybody else, they wanted to make videos popular and they wanted to make money out of it, basically. So what they did, they made a close group of 4 friends and they went to a village. There was absolutely no cost in making it, but they made wonderful human experience during lockdowns, wonderful human emotions carved through these very humorous ways and very, very appealing ways they conducted themselves. And by default, these videos, without giving too much of any publicity, it went like wildfire. And it has caught like wildfire.
It was released on YouTube.
It's released on YouTube. The premiere. You can also watch it.
Sure.
And they are making 3 or 4 series like that. And people are waiting for such videos to come. This is one way to look at it. They haven't made anything unusual. They are very crude. They are very sensible. They made human life shown in a package in a different way, humorously, well watchable, good visuals with very limited crew to make it within control, and they make it. And there are also good messages or thematic references that come by at the end of the video. It's hardly about 3.5 minutes. So what I'm trying to say here is anything can work provided you have put in a definition about what you want, especially in movies or stories. Parallels. Okay, this is working, so this has to go like this. Is something I don't think it's a proven principle. It might or may not happen. But at the same time, you stand by your principles, you stand by your convictions, and go ahead with that. And I always say that there is a moral responsibility for every writer to make, I would call it, a certain layer of consciousness to what is needed to this society. We need that responsibility at some point. I'm not saying at the cost of any economic output or economic viability. We need to do all that. But there is always some kind of a thematic relevance somewhere. Because stories are for that. Stories actually are meant to be that. So when I say the demands, we are saying that, okay, why don't you make a series about killing? The nuances of killing. It will work, the producer says. Will you do that? You can still do that. You can see umpteen number of such films in dark web, and they make a hell of a lot of money. But can we do that? So we are in a moral fiber, and we are responsible in that fiber to make that fiber sustain.
So when you're talking about, you know, we have this, you know, before we start writing something, we can think about, you know, what is needed. And, you know, like how they create a product, if there is a mosquito problem, you know, what you need now is a mosquito repellent. Can stories be used like that, sir?
No, I think stories are great influencers. Because why it influences is I am actually looking for certain clues to make my life better. That's why I watch movies. I don't want to watch a movie and make my life worse. So I am always looking up to making my life better. This is basically the crux or the emotional codes that we contain is actually asking for it. So the writer has some kind of a responsibility to give the audiences what they're looking for. Maybe it's a strange thing. They wouldn't have thought about it. The writer thinks about it and presents it to them.
How does the writer? That's
what we do.
What does an audience want?
It is very difficult to know what the audiences want because you don't know the audience. The audiences are many, many layered. It is all scattered. But I would call it, the writer has a fresh impetus to, or a fresh platter to offer that he thinks is the right thing that I have to do. It actually generates from there, not from the audience perspective. The audience, in whichever way a story is being told, will like it, if it is told well. Even Robert McKee, you would have read about that book called The Story by Robert McKee. And many people have discussed over the same thing. Here, it is all about packaging something. If you have a great story, it doesn't mean that the great story works. It is a great story, well told, is that works. So you need to find and define ways and means to tell it well. That's why we learn structure. That's why we learn so many other things to make and package it so that the telling goes well.
So the way you tell it is the screenplay.
Absolutely. The structure. Mm-hmm.
So the
story remains the same anyway.
So we need to learn this process of structuring a story. Like there is a
absolutely, Ajay.
Process
absolutely.
To teach to students also. And would very earlier I used to think that, you know, I shouldn't educate myself on any of these, you know, processes, because I wanted to come up with something very new. But later on, I decided, you know, that was not a good thing. Can you explain to people, sir, why you need to learn?
See, I'll tell you, because many of the young writers who approach me has this, because we always tend to defy the principles. We tend to defy. Our nature is to defy. Because why we defy is to give my own identity to what I am saying. This is why I want to do things the way I look at it. This is why everyone would want to know that. The major reason is to make yourself identifiable as a writer or a maker. That's why we need to come out of the cliche, or we need to come out of the crowd and show that I am different. But at the same time, I always opt, there are no thrust rules for writing or making films or making a structure. There are no thrust rules, but there are always principles. These principles are nothing but experiences of writers over many, many years across languages and geographies. This is how principles have set in. So they think, because we have the same question, okay, I've made this film, I have written this story, so how am I going to attract the audiences? The same question has been asked millions of years ago or hundreds of years ago. And this is why they say, when I did this, this happened. When I did this, it was easier for crowd to come into me. And they appreciated it. So this is how principles form. So at some point of time, if we know the principles, we'll be in an easier condition to contradict it sometimes. But we need to know those principles. It is not to execute it in your films, it's only to contradict it, because you know that it works this way. So I want to go about it. When the principles that you come to know, when you learn those principles, there is always a reason behind those principles. That also you learn. It is not just being given to you blind and say that, well, you just do it like this because these are principles. Nobody will buy it.
It is not a formula.
It's not a formula at all. It is all given and mentored my reasons over many years of writing and millions of writers writing. So this actually gives an overall picture about what may go wrong and what may be right. And once you have an idea about it, then you have a better judgment about what you do. It's as good as that. And even when you go for principles, you would call it, okay, I want to have a narration which is not classic in nature. I want to go for a non-linear narration, or I want to do it like, I want to tell a story like chapters. All these, well and good. But ultimately, what's your aim? It is to impress an audience. It is to give what best you have written as the best package to the audience. This is what you intend. And those principles will definitely analyze what you have written. You can do it yourself. If you like it, you take it. Otherwise, you go ahead and do what you have to, because if that convinces you that this is the best way to tell my story, go ahead and do it. You will learn by doing it. In most of the cases, people come to me after doing four short films, and they realize that after doing four short films, they realize there is something that you need to think about screenplay. Mm-hmm. Till then, we have this complacent way of doing it. This is what I have to do. And so when I tell you for sure that the more you learn about writing and structure, you realize that you are just at the tip of the iceberg. And over these 30 years, I tell you, I realize I need to learn a lot more. So that makes you humble in many ways. And look at things in a very clear set mind and analytical mind and with reasons. Mm-hmm. And giving you a priority to write from your heart first with all the mistakes. Because we all have this great complacency that I'm a great genius, that I will make my first draft the perfect one. That is a very rare thing to happen. And we should have the courage to and patience to look at your first draft and willing to make remakes after remakes before you can ever sit and relax. Maybe it's hundreds of rewrites that you're looking forward to. Am I talking a little too long, Ajay?
No, sir. I'm loving it. I have so many questions more, sir.
Okay, please.
It's amazing to hear, you know, the process of writing and, you know, the human side of writing and everything. And so there is so much of understanding and, you know, work you put into writing. I sometimes enjoy writing, you know, to some extent, you know, truthfully, where I feel like, you know, I'm not thinking about the world outside me. I'm just inside the writing world. And there are some days where I don't want to write at all. I think maybe I'm not talented enough to, you know, have the skill. Maybe I've just, you know, convinced myself that I can write. On most days, I feel like, you know, I am not a writer. I wrote few stories by fluke.
Okay. That actually is a very humble way you look at what you do. But at the same time, There is a lot that you can rely on. This is what I keep on saying. The reliance that you should have is with yourself and your experience of life. Your subconscious is a great, great innovator and a great, I would say, curator of things. And believe in your subconscious. This is one thing that actually takes you from your heart and put it on paper first. But when you put that on paper, you may have a lot of defects there. And these defects have to be corrected or curated, or not curated, it has to be corrected and placed well according to a certain process that we learn through. It will help you. And one other thing I always find is, very simply speaking, it is not about your skill or talent. You need to learn this process, and that will definitely help you get into a track of doing things. The process will take you through certain things because it carries that ways of doing things at that point of time, and then go from there to there. It is exactly like making a home. What do you do first when you make a home? Or you go find a land and then you test your soil out there. It is a process. You cannot make the entire structure out there and then you go test the soil. Is it the right way to go about it? Is my question. So there is always a process to go certain things which will make your work a lot easier and convincing. So you can confidently move from one process to the other. It's like a flow chart that you're talking about. So from there, you grow and reach a first draft, and then you revise it, and then you make it and lock it. All this will be through a process which you can very well rely on. That's a major easy way of, getting into the writing slot. So one thing is, we are not that talent base can be nurtured by your learning the process, is what I'm saying. More than the talent part of it. There are certain crucial things that you have to learn first. Writing is the only thing that you take it for granted, that you think that, oh, I don't have to learn anything because I know. I don't have to learn at all because I know the words. I can write sentences. So I can write a story. I don't have to learn anything. So that actually is not, that's a partial knowledge of things.
I guess maybe it's because if I'm learning a sport like tennis or something, that I can, judge my improvement by the number of matches I play and whether I'm scoring more points. There isn't any physical thing to, judge where I'm progressing, or is there one? I'm not sure.
No, I think we can have a process where you'll check. There are checklists available. There are possibilities of how structure can be checked, how the character elements can be checked. If you add in these kind of elements, how the characters can grow. How can you make layers in a character? And what will contribute to story? At which stage the story can be confined as, decided as story. And most of the basic, or rather the recurring problem that I find with young writers is they start with structure without a story. They start telling the story without a story. This is a very crucial defect, and that's not the process. We should first have a story in hand to tell a story. So the very word storytelling means that you have to have a story first before you tell. Otherwise, how can you tell that completely well and effectively well? So here we start with scenes, and the scenes grow. And scenes can grow only superficially if your character doesn't have depth, if your story doesn't have layers, or story doesn't have completion and perfection. The scenes become just peripheral. So at some point of time, just by making scenes, you realize that it doesn't give you much and you won't know where to go from there. Because scene writing is more or less the last thing that you write in this process. And most of young writers write it first. I'm not saying, I have to just contradict what I'm saying. I have also come up with an excellent short film in when I was a jury in a college, in a university. And it was a beautifully narrated character, and the scenic conditions and everything was. So I would call it a propagator of, process of writing. I asked this young boy, he's a young, I think he should hardly be about 21 or 22 max. So I asked him, what was your process? He said, no, sir, there was no process. I just wrote what I thought. It came by and I never rewrote anything. I was written it all half in a page, and then I went for shoot. I did this, and then I edited it, and this is my product. I just embraced him and say that you are a genius. Yeah, true. I just loved him the way he conducted himself to make this movie. The point here is only one thing. This can be a coincidence. It has to be repeated. When you want to repeat what best you have done as a coincidence, unless you know the principles, it could be very difficult for you. There are umpteen number of writer directors who they don't write at all. They have made exquisite films. There are two ways to look at it. One, when you don't write, or when everything is kept in your mindset and then you create as and when it comes, the planning process goes to deficit. So you engage yourself in spending more. So that's one other great thing about writing a screenplay. It actually confines, it controls the cost of making, because you know what you are making. Otherwise, you decide in the sets means you are making every decision in the set as it is coming by. Sometimes you wouldn't know what to make. You wouldn't have the right material around you. Suddenly a thought will come to you, okay, I'm going to make this guy ride a bicycle, and there is no bicycle around to shoot. So these things can literally make the production costs go high. And not, generally, these are the two ways to look at it. One, the coincidental success may not be repeated per se. And the principles and process will make you get to that success recurringly. This is success means the communicability, and the best way to tell a story is what I mean by success, when you have more audiences to favor you for what you have done. So this can definitely be supported if you have a process to hang on to. And then the budgetary controls.
So when we are talking about the movie, sir, there is sometimes, particularly in Tamil cinema, a lot of us directors, you know, we have this feeling that we have to write the story also. We have to be the writer also. And there is another reason to it also, because I don't see where I can go and engage with the writer or pick up a story from another writer and direct it. I don't know where to reach them also. Is there a way to, you know, bring the directors and writers together? Or
this is one major initiative I've been trying to work, Ajay. Mm-hmm. I'm actually now come up with a platform called Writers Table. This mm-hmm. Writers Table is there. It's a virtual table where writers can come in and hang out, and if they have products, and if they can discuss among them, they can find their own partners if they want to, and probably discuss things there. We'll also provide a virtual library kind of, and make movies connected, mentoring, clarifying certain things. All these are possible in that group. And also, if we have a product, then I'm also trying to bring in the other segments of filmmaking, like producers or directors or people who have decision-making capacities to make a movie, so that we can identify good creative content for movies and OTTs, and even short films for that matter. Somebody may have to make a short film and they were looking for a movie, I mean, subjects. So this is a platform of a network of writers, per se, and then connecting them to possible other segments in the community, industry, as production partners or direction partners or people like that. So this is a forum that I am actually looking forward to. Now we also have about a good number of writers through our programs, and they are very live and discussing well. And so probably this can be one major step that we should be looking forward to in the near future.
So this is an ongoing process which you are planning to launch in the future?
Or? Yes, it's already it's ongoing. It's there in my website. You can be a register your name in the website and participate in that. There is an ongoing discussion live going on there, and this is now just going. I've just started a couple of weeks back. I wanted to make it into a physical thing, but more than the physical thing, I think the virtual thing helps a lot, and it's easier to maintain. So I think a lockdown has taught us these kind of new technologies to work and make the career going smoother, you know.
So how do you this situation we are in today, how do you see it affecting the future of cinema?
No, I think future of cinema will still be there. See, that's what I'm saying. Please don't take it as cinema. I always see it as story. So cinema is a story, and because there are theaters, multiplexes available, cinema will have to stand because it's an industrial necessity. One. Now, when it comes to OTT platforms, the change of viewing a picture or a movie pattern is changed because everything is connected with your individual watching. The mass watching is being restricted. We are getting content for individual watching. So at this point, I realize that I think that there will be exclusive content to be watched, supported by stars, which will come in theaters. And they have control over running the theaters, because if it is supported by stars, the stars definitely will have fandom. And the fans will have to watch it in theaters. So that support structure will still maintain. At the same time, whatever movies that come in theaters will have more spectacle, and the draw of spectacle will work to its favor. And the kind of movies or originals that come by OTT will have content which could be specific for individual watching, which cannot be shown in theaters per se, or rather easily shown in theaters per se. There may be, because it's mass viewing, there may be a lot of censoring, and the type of censoring also may change, but there will be a lot of censoring because it's a collective watching. So these two platforms or these two content definitions will sustain. Definitely it will sustain. So I think we need both. We need both. Both will sustain.
Outdoor shoots will be possible.
Yes, of course. Yes, of course. It's all. I think in Mumbai and even in Chennai and other spaces, they're actually looking forward to restructuring shooting. And now there are some clauses that actors above 65 and less than 10 years will be restricted for the time being. All those special norms will happen, but at the same time, shooting will definitely happen. Shooting will happen. I don't think so. This will have a long... The only thing is that we are waiting to change the life pattern with a lot of control or hygienic controls, and the way in which the methodology may change a little bit here and there, but the number of people. One other thing I look forward, I think will happen, is the budgets will have to come down, especially in theaters, because at least for some time the theaters are likely to, even if they open, they can start with only 50% capacity. the entire seat capacities, 50% only will be allowed initially. So the revenue, the revenues that may come may be limited. So I think producers will look forward to making movies for theaters at a specific budget, at least for some time, till it is regularized. But I think my personal opinion is it won't just die off like that, because story, you can, that's what I say, you cannot just put stories away from human lives. Stories have to be there. It has to be present. It plays a vital role in morality and societal building.
But do you think, you know, the very young generation, what we call as the Gen Z, you know, who have grown up with internet and cell phones, that's their native platform. And you have been, you know, I have noticed that you have been very technologically, you know, updated when it comes to, you know, what people are consuming, how they are consuming stories. So you are one of the first person I heard saying that, you know, you spoke about TikTok in a very positive light. So that was very interesting to hear, sir. Can we hear some more from you, sir?
No, what I realize is the new gen or the internet based entertainment is different. You know, that's what I again and again I say. The internet based crowd actually has very. It is not about wisdom that we are talking about. It is about information based content is what they are looking at, and it's more sporadic. It's more reality based, and short reality based snippets is what they are looking at. So basically, and now it is a quickie kind of a thing of less than 10 minutes of content is what can be really viable for a crowd like that. And mostly they look forward to cheesy or very lighthearted stuff. Not going into the depth of things, but some kind of information will entice them. For example, what I'm saying is there is an information about a new type of mobile phone, for example, a new type of mobile phone, maybe an artificially intelligent product as a character. This may have more value than an in-depth emotional character for this crowd, basically. And TikTok is not just been just a, I would call it a meme or what you call a trolling stuff kind of a thing. Trolling again is something quite interestingly watched by that, but the trolling has to be directed well. That itself, I find excellent genius stuff in trolling. You just laugh your gut out by certain trolling stuff that they come up with. So I find a lot of creativity in there, though it is very short-lived, or the pattern of all those things will come and go. So they just go for, they don't, it is not a sustaining, they keep on making continually, you know. That's what I say, it is more based on reality-based content, which will have an impact on this particular crowd, because it's very short-lived information that's passed on. It's not any big moral statements that you are making. It's just passing an information from one to the other for a short period of time. So this is basically the nature of this kind of audiences and makers, for that matter.
Don't they have the need to watch the story and feel that empathetic connection like most of us?
I think again the empathy stuff is very rare with this crowd, but it has to be very superficially conducted. No big in-depth thing that, that's what I'm saying. The nature is psychology by itself. The psychological status itself is shifting. You look at one information I'll give you. When it comes to these kind of crowd, online stuff or even movies, how many superhero movies are coming on stage or coming to be released in the world of movies nowadays. It is not real-time character. These are all superhero films. In there is some portion of life which is shown, but not all the emotional ties are all there. But at the same time, it is all very light-hearted stuff. Not big emotional things are not shown there. And all the superheroes coming to one platform and then one story and then they move about. So it's a different version of many superheroes being treated in many different ways. This is one thing that I see in this with this new generation audiences, you know. So we need to connect some kind, that's what I'm saying. It's more of a light passing by kind of stuff, which is more reality based.
I have an observation. Yeah. I feel that it's because we have so many options and so little time to devote to each. To maybe empathetically feel for a character or someone, we would need at least more than 15 seconds. So when we have only 15 seconds on TikTok, obviously the superficial stuff might work. I saw TikTok once, sir. I was on the platform for about 2.5 hours, and I found a lot of channels after 2 hours. Very creatively done, you know, just shot with their phone, and I had no idea how they shot it, all the teams. So I was wondering that, you know, if I could bring the sense of you know, learning which I've had from watching movies like you know, Guna and other stuff, is it possible to bring that quality in the 15 second video?
No, there are 5 seconds. I've seen a series of 5 to 6 second series. It's a very quickie kind of a very short series. On TikTok is what I remember. Yes.
Okay.
Yes. It came to my mobile phone. Somebody sent it to me and I watched it, and it's hardly about 5 to 6 seconds. That's all.
Each episode. Okay.
And it gives you a moral statement within that 6 seconds.
Wow.
It's beautifully done. It's beautifully done. So what I'm trying to say is, if we need to communicate well within the 10 seconds, it is possible. But it has to have the concurrence of modern life, is what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
It has to be innovative. It has to have the modernity to blend, the information to blend into it. I am not talking about wisdom. Please see that nowadays the generation doesn't have the wisdom, because they are not keen about the wisdom, because they don't know about it. They eventually, at some stage, when they grow up to 40, 45, this present generation, from 18 to 45, when they reach 45, they'll start thinking about a mild way of looking at life. Because they would have passed through certain stages of life.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they are passing through a system-based or industry-driven life pattern with gadgets and modernity. They are actually enjoying what they are going through. Everything is that they go through, they try to enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
And there is no major catastrophe. That is the only... Probably I'll realize that this pandemic is going to give them a new angle of life. Pandemic. The 60 days at home. That's what I'm saying. They're actually going back to the agrarian outlook than the industrial outlook, because industries are closed. Industries are not working. The consumerism is not working. Industries are all closed down. And then they start looking, they are inside their room. And then they start looking at life in a different perspective. All the gadget or the OTTs or the internet-based things is what they are watching, maybe games or whatever. But at the same time, they are having a different mindset, or they are given a different opportunity to look at life in a different way. That's what I'm saying. If there is some kind of a changed life pattern arrives, that will drive the whole concept to a different level. So at some point of time, I heard in Mumbai, the stars made a conscientizing film, Amitabh Bachchan included, Mr. Amitabh Bachchan included. Mm-hmm. They made it. Okay. Now, look at the way that movie was made. Why that concept of making such a movie happened? Because the situation demanded. Or else nobody would have tried it. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Can you repeat the last sentence, sir? It got stuck. Sorry.
No. Had this pandemic not been there, would anybody think of doing such a kind of film? No.
No way. No way.
No way. So we are adapting to conditions. And human mind, humans are the only species who can adapt to conditions. We will adapt to conditions.
So is there a process to write, you know, small 15 seconds stories?
No, it is. There is always a story has to arrive out of a theme. Basically, the process is basically the theme. And within the 15 seconds, how am I going to communicate? Whatever be the theme.
Okay.
So, the crucial element that you need is the theme. So, that you need to define. Yeah.
So, sir, I've always wondered that, you know, almost everyone talks about that the most important thing for a movie success or anything is a strong script. Script is everything. And we have seen, many movies, big stars movies becoming flops because the story was not good. So it kind of is obvious that this is the core element for anything. But how come the writers or the stories are not paid well? Where did this whole thing happen? I can't really understand.
Now I think we are coming through better times, Ajay. That was the situation.
Okay.
We are coming through better times. Now content has been respected. And content writers are integral part of a movie and especially web series. Web series is, or the OTT content is what made writers known. Because of their writing. And earlier in some industries like vernacular industry, say for example Malayalam, writers are always respected. People, even movies used to run with writers' names in Malayalam industry. Now generally there is a respect growing with writers, and the writers' remuneration is standardized because of certain associations even have prescribed certain parliament, proposed certain conditions to parliament. And the Screenwriters Association in Mumbai is actually have been a venue for all these conditions to grow, status to grow, and they were working hard on it. But now generally I think writers can claim decent money, reasonably good money for their products. And copywriting has become more popular, and so writers have that status now, reasonably good.
Reasonably so good. This is, I can't, that was such a wonderful interview. I can go on and on, but... We had to end. So
I know your questions also were very, very inspiring, so that I could talk whichever way possible. But hope I answered most of your questions.
You
in the right perspective.
I have so much clarity now, sir, in this 1 hour. So I would like to, I ask this question at the end of an interview because I feel, most creators, they get so much into the into becoming the master of their craft. Sometimes they don't understand the, marketing aspect or the economy aspect. And what would you tell the writer, sir? How can they make money, good money, so
I
that.
myself, yes, I am myself not a marketer, as you say, but I am trying to learn it now because one is the writer has to find pockets of security for first his writing, the content itself. So that first should be secured with some kind of copyrights, and you should also find prototype markets for you. This is one thing that I would recommend.
Could you elaborate
You
on
should
prototype markets?
prototype means you are inventing a market.
Okay.
You are inventing in a market.
Hmm.
So, as for writers, I believe there is no competition between writers because everyone who writes the way he does can never have a competition because the other guy will have something different as a USP. So, in this, the writer will have to, because now YouTube or internet platforms in many ways contribute to your prototype assessments or developing a prototype. A writer can make umpteen number of innovative approaches to writing and make it audio visual. And I would call it most of the writers to get into this democratized audio visual exercise. I mean, audio visual making exercise, because now that writing is at their fingertips, they also should learn the making of it so that it becomes easy for them to propose new, innovative, differently perceived projects, which can find its own markets and the prototype things. So basically, I find a lot of opportunity, not just confining to dramatic writing. This is what we should analyze, that lots of prototypes happen outside the dramatic writing too. So, like something that you write for reality or the reality shows per se, something you write about writing about documentaries, writing about some kind of pockets of life which is not explored. So apart from the dramatic writing, there should be some other ways of writing which has to be a writer's sole prototype invention. That is a prototype created by him. That actually will help a lot for writers, is what I feel. I hope by meaning prototype is to find a pocket. See, for example, I teach screenwriting. That is a prototype for a writer. I realize this can be well packaged, or my knowledge or my experience has been shared for those who want to learn. That doesn't mean that I'm not a writer. I can parallelly write at the same time. That is a prototype which I have created over a period of time. So somebody, as you were asking, let us look at a 10-minute writing or a 10-second writing. How does it work? And you are creating that prototype. Probably there are other aspects, even like blending the dramatic storytelling writing, even with technical writing for that, user manuals. How can you dramatize a user manual? This can be a prototype. I'm just bluntly saying. Suppose if you have a user manual, you're dramatizing the user manual so that one doesn't have to read it. The story takes you through that. So this again can be a prototype. And the opportunity is unlimited. So we need to create that because we are writers, only we can do it, is what I mean.
Sir, you teach classes online, and I have been your student. And could you please tell people watching, you know, where can they find you?
Well, we have a website called www.screenwrite.in, where all the details of our programs are shown. And there is also a telephone number. My good friend Nipin has been behind it, coordinating effectively, and his expertise in finding people and coordinating them is showing off in many ways. And he also can be connected in 9840833689. You know, he's always available there. Or you can even connect with admin@screenwrite.in by email. So these are the possibilities. The avenues are open 24/7, and I am actually keen to find as many young aspirants and talk with them. That is again my passion. That's why I follow it. So apart from my writing jobs, I find exclusively time every day, some time, and to talk with aspiring writers, so students of screenwriting and aspiring writers. So I am always committed to that. I am open, and you can connect with Nipin or me, or in this website, through this website. We are always there for you.
Sir, it was a pleasure talking to you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much.
Better interview.
Thank you very much, Ajay. It was again a treat to me too, you know. Thanks very much for your time, and I hope we had more time like this in the future. We will come back to that. Thanks very much for your efforts, and for your channel I give my entire support and congratulations.
Thank you
for your channel. Thanks very much.